welcome to part two of our section on Hinduism. Today we have, or in this lecture, we have a lot to talk about. This might end up being a little bit of a long lecture, but it's going to be a very important one, not just for the section on Hinduism, but all the sections on Asian religion. If you have any questions, please email me. I'll do my best to explain some of these difficult concepts. We're going to talk today about the philosophical, theological roots of Hinduism, about what Hinduisms believe about themselves, the universe, and the unseen reality. And we're going to talk a lot about Dharma, the concept of Dharma. It's very important. As I mentioned in the last lecture, Indians or Hindus do not have a word for religion the way we do. And yet, religion is imbued in every part of their life. And they call this Dharma, which means, can be interpreted as religion, it can be interpreted as many things, one of which is truth. On this first page, I have a quote from one of the Upanishads, which, as you'll remember, is one of the Shruti texts. It says, "Verily," which means truly, "that which is Dharma is truth. Therefore, they say of a man who speaks the truth, he speaks the Dharma. Or of a man who speaks the Dharma, he speaks the truth. Verily, both these things are the same." So we're going to start today by talking about the Bhagavad Gita, which is a section from the Mahabharata, which we talked about in the last lecture. It's one of the two great epics in Hindu literature. The other of which is the Ramayana, which you had a chance to review a little bit already. And then we're going to use the lessons from the Bhagavad Gita to talk more about karma, dharma, moksha, atman, brahman, yoga, and several other key concepts in Hinduism. Now on this page you're going to see a picture. You can see a man who's kneeling before this figure. This is a scene from the Mahabharata and from the Bhagavad Gita, which is a section of the Mahabharata. This is the Prince Arjuna kneeling before Krishna, who is a Hindu god, a Hindu deity, a very important one. And this is a scene that is replicated all over India. You'll see this again and again, this prince kneeling before Krishna. And I think this is a lovely rendition. I want to take a look at it. Arjuna, you can see he's in his chariot. And here's Krishna. And behind him, you can see Vishnu. We're going to talk more about the various gods in the next lecture. But for now, we'll just focus on Krishna and Vishnu. So Krishna is actually a manifestation of Vishnu. In Hinduism and Buddhism, there's this idea of reincarnation, that your soul, your Atman, continually goes through life cycles, and the gods use this to their advantage by being reincarnated or being incarnated as people on earth, oftentimes to right wrongs, to correct karmic imbalances, or to teach lessons. And so Krishna is one of the most famous incarnations of Vishnu. But behind Vishnu, you can see many more faces, right? There's this idea here that Krishna is Vishnu, but Vishnu is all of the other gods as well. All of these deities, these divinities, are linked. They're connected. They're related to each other. But let's focus on this scene right here of Arjuna and Krishna. So in the Mahabharata, it's the story of this famous epic of family ties, of loyalty and duty and betrayal. It all comes down to, as I mentioned before in the last lecture, it all comes down to the story of this royal family that becomes divided amongst itself over issues of power. And at the climax, this long, long epic that's, I think I said it's 12 times longer than the Bible. It's an incredibly long story. All these little subplots and so many characters and things like that. The climax, finally, the two sides of the struggle meet on the battlefield to finally have it out. And Arjuna, who's a prince and who's a good son and is a model for being a good person, just as Rama is in the Ramayana is a model for being a good person. Right? Remember that these stories are teaching stories. They teach people about how to live and how to be. So Prince Arjuna is on the battlefield, and he looks across at this other army that is made up of his kin and his people from his own kingdom, and he just becomes very despairing, and he realizes that there's no way he can win this. Either they're going to beat him, and they're going to take over power, which is not theirs, they don't deserve, or he's going to win. His army is going to win, and he will have killed his own family members. So he feels like there's nothing he can do. So his charioteer, his servant man, is there with him. And Prince Arjuna doesn't know that his servant man is actually Krishna in disguise. Right? Krishna's come down. He's been incarnated and is hiding as his charioteer for this very moment so he can teach Arjuna. So Krishna, the form of the charioteer, sees Arjuna just throw down his weapons and just sit down. He doesn't know what to do. He feels like he can't do anything. And Arjuna decides, I'm not going to do anything. His only choice feels like inaction, is to not choose either of these choices in front of him. And Krishna comes to him and says, what are you doing? You have to do this. And Arjuna explains his doubts. And Krishna's counsel, the Bhagavad Gita, this is kind of the basis for how we understand Dharma and Karma and all these things. Krishna tells him, your problem is that you think this world that you live in is real. This is not real. This is all just illusion. The only thing that is real is the Atman. Atman, which is the word basically for soul, for self. The self with a capital S. That's the only thing that's real. We're all just kind of stuck in the mire of samsara. Samsara means illusion. This world is called samsara. It's not real. The only thing that's real is the Atman. And people mistake samsara, illusion, for reality, and they become attached to it. They think that the consequences of the actions here in this world are important when they're not. They're not even real. And Krishna tells him, you can't kill the other army because you can't touch what they really are. Their true selves, capital S, their true selves, their Atman. You can't touch that. That's what's real. And he tells him, he explains to him, well, Krishna doesn't go deeply into karma, into the Bhagavad Gita, but it's hinted at. It's hinted that everyone's stuck in this cycle of karma, which is action and consequences, which lead to more actions and more consequences, the result of which is that we have to be continually reincarnated into this world because of the consequences of our actions. We're constantly dealing with these consequences, right? Krishna tells him, what you have to do is you have to look at the bigger picture. You have to look outside what you see and consider that God, that the divine, has a plan. And this somehow fits into the universe, right? That all of our actions, all of our reincarnations, our karma, is us trying to restore balance to the universe, right? All of these actions create karma, like a pendulum or a spinning wheel. And that we need to play out the consequences of our actions, and we need to not be attached to this world in order to play out the consequences of our actions and return balance to the universe, and also to to play out our own karma so we won't have any more. The only way out of this life is through liberation. And that means releasing your built-up karma. There's no good karma or bad karma. Try to forget anything you've ever heard about there being good karma and bad karma. Karma means you're stuck here. And you have to release that karma in order to be, in order to get out of the cycle of reincarnation and be liberated and find reunion with the divine, with the Brahman, which we'll talk about in a second. So Krishna explains all of this to him, and he says, look, there's a big picture here, right? This doesn't mean that, you know, by being detached from this world, that doesn't mean you shouldn't act. In fact, dharma means acting. Dharma means acting. Dharma means duty. Dharma means you need to do what you were put in this world to do. And not question it so much, because you can't understand the greater plan. You can't understand the series of dominoes. Think of dominoes, you know, one knocking the next over. You can't understand what has led you here to this moment and where it's leading. So you must act, and the only thing you need to be detached to is the concept of this world, which is illusion. And also, even though you act, you have to be detached from the results of your actions. Instead, act based on dharma, based upon what is right and what is true, based upon moral righteousness, and don't be concerned with the results of those actions. You don't need to worry about the results of those actions. And this is dharma. This is what dharma is. It is a way of thinking. It's also a way of life. And it is, for Hindus, religion. That is what religion is. It's more about practice and the way you live your life than it is about your beliefs. In Western religion, we're very much attached to this idea of belief. You know, you have to believe in God. You have to believe in, you know, Allah or in Jesus or whoever. In Eastern religions, they're much more orthoprax, which is to say they're much more about acting in a correct way. It's not so much about your beliefs. And that's a major, major difference from Eastern and Western religion. And I don't want to overgeneralize too much Eastern and Western, you know, religions. That would be a mistake. Certainly, there is practice is an important part of many Christian denominations. It's a very important part of Judaism and Islam. And certainly, you know, there's some belief necessary in Eastern religions. Otherwise, why do you do what you do? But it's more about how you define yourself and how you define your tradition. And for Hindus, it's Hinduism is very much a way of life. It's about following your dharma. So Arjuna's eyes are opened. He understands. He realizes that this man he's been talking to is really Krishna. And he goes out and he fights the battle and he wins the war. And everything turns out okay in the end. Not everything. But that's the basis of the Bhagavad Gita. It's a climax. It's a very important work within Hindu literature. So, Hindu philosophy. Here we have a picture of a lotus, included because it is a common picture in Hinduism, also in Buddhism. They use it in the art a lot, and it's an important symbol, both for karma and for dharma, and for Atman, for that matter. So the lotus, what you have to understand about a lotus is that they grow in the water and their roots reach all the way down into the mud, right? So their roots, so they literally grow out of the mud and they grow up through the water, and on the top of the water you see this, you know, this beautiful flower. Another interesting thing about them is they keep their seed pod with them even as they flower, which is unusual for flowers. Usually the flower dies and then the seed forms. This is one plant where the flower and the seed are together. So what it is often, what it represents, for one thing it represents the Atman, the self. That basically the self is something that's true and the world is something that's not true. So like the lotus, the Atman grows out of the mud, it grows out of samsara, down at the bottom of the pond. And it reaches above samsara, and only by reaching above samsara and finding the sun can it bloom. It is also a symbol for karma, in that a seed is of course considered the cause of a plant, just as actions create consequences. And in Hinduism, there's this idea that your actions and consequences are all kind of the same thing. It's the cycle, right? You do something and it causes something else to happen. And it's all kind of connected. Just like here in this flower, you have the cause of the flower and the result of the flower, or the result of the seed together. So it represents karma and also represents Atman. It's also a symbol commonly used for Vishnu and for his wife Lakshmi and their son and their children, and it's kind of it's an important symbol. Those are the main things. Okay, so first concept is that of Brahman. So Hinduism has many deities, as we've talked about, millions of deities. But above all these deities is the ultimate reality, the one ultimate reality, which is Brahma, which we talked about in the first lecture. The Upanishads talk about Brahma, the one, the original, the one who is alone, that thou art. If you remember that quote from the first lecture, you can look it up in the PowerPoint notes that I posted. Right, that's Brahma. Brahman is unknowable and above everything else, and from Brahman, everything else comes, including the gods themselves. Brahman manifests in many personal deities. So within Hinduism, you have all these deities, and you kind of, you don't get to pick and choose like a buffet line, but to some extent, you know, you do have some freedom in who you follow. Usually, most people will follow whatever god or goddess their parents devoted to. But then they also have the choice to bring in devotions to other deities that they might be interested in. So a lot of times you kind of even have people who have personal deities, deities that are important to them personally, which is very interesting, but it all comes from Brahma. The true essence of life, what we talked about, the Atman, the soul, self, is Brahman trapped in matter, right? So your Atman, yourself, is a little bit of Brahman that thou art. It's the quote from the Upanishad from the first lecture. The purpose of all of this is of this world, or the purpose of what we do, of following the Dharma and trying to release built up karma, is to release the Atman, find liberation so the Atman can return to Brahman and become one again, become whole again. Dharma, as I mentioned, can be translated in many different ways. Here are just some of the ways it can be translated. It's your duty, right? Your duty based upon where you were born and who your parents are, and your social obligations. It's law, it's teachings, it's moral order of society, in order that there be peace and harmony amongst people. It's righteousness, it's religion, it's truth, it's a proper way of life. It's a way of living. That's Dharma. Reincarnation, as I mentioned, is the Atman continually being born into this world, lifetime after lifetime. The world is known as samsara. And Hindus do believe that you can be reincarnated either as a person or as an animal. It's best, from the Hindu point of view, to be reborn as a person, because only as a person can you study and learn and understand your situation. You know, only people have consciousness allow us to understand that we're stuck in samsara, so that we can work our way out of it. Animals, of course, don't have that choice. However, Hindus still do teach that you need a certain kindness to animals. Hindus are by and large vegetarian. They don't use animal skins because all animals have souls. And one teaching that's taught both by Hindus and Buddhists is that you should be kind to every person and every animal you see, because each of us has been through so many reincarnations, probably, you know, countless reincarnations, that we've come into contact with probably all the souls that are out there, all the Atman that are out there. And you don't know that any animal or person that you meet might have been your mother in a past life, or your wife, or your husband, or your child. So you should treat everyone with respect, and you should treat animals as well with respect, and not make them suffer. Because by doing so, you know, you're creating karma for yourself. Karma. The book explains it as spiritual impurity, which I think is a good way of explaining it. It's due to actions that keep us bound to this world, both good and bad. Karma is about consequences. It's not about reward and punishment. So there is an idea that if you do good things, your karma will bring good consequences. And if you do bad things, your karma will bring bad consequences. So that's where this idea of good and bad karma comes from. But all the same, no karma, even if it brings good consequences, is good. Because karma is what keeps us anchored in samsara. Karma is what keeps us anchored in this cycle. Even if you have karma from good actions, and the good consequences are maybe you're reborn into a really, you know, a good life as a high class person with a lot of money and you know, a lot of good things, it's still not good because you're still stuck doing actions that are keeping you stuck. So when we talk about karma, you know, the Westerners have kind of adopted this word karma like it's something that means like justice or getting what you deserve, you want to get good karma so good things happen to you. And that's not really what karma means. And that's really important to understanding Hinduism and Buddhism. So the ultimate goal of life is to release the Atman by releasing all your pent-up karma and reunite with the divine, becoming as one with the Brahman. This is called moksha. Moksha means liberation. Not all people, though not all Hindus, necessarily think themselves as seeking moksha. I have a Hindu friend who told me that a lot of times Hindus who might feel like they haven't led a very good life, Hindus who tend to have a lot of regrets, don't necessarily think of themselves as seeking moksha. People who, as we'll see, people who spend the last, you know, part of their life, the twilight of their life, old age, in, devoting themselves to religion so that they can reach moksha, usually have a confidence that they've lived a certain good life, that they haven't built up more karma for themselves. So it's not really spoken about a lot by Hindus, moksha. But as people get older, certainly as Hindus start to get older, it starts to come on their mind. So these concepts are really key. Brahman, Atman, Dharma, Samsara, Karma, Moksha. These are really, really important. If you have more questions about them, about what they mean, the book, page 77, 77 in the ninth edition, the newest edition, goes through each of them. Does a really good job of explaining them. If you have more questions about them, let me know. This is one section that I really want you to work on and try to wrap your heads around these concepts, because these concepts get kind of reinterpreted by Buddhism, and through Buddhism and Hinduism get spread throughout the rest of Asia. So pretty much up until midterms, when we end our section on Asian religion, we're going to be coming back to these concepts again and again and again. And it's fascinating to see the way they spread, the way they're reinterpreted. So if you have trouble with any of these, let me know. So society, how do all of these things kind of play out in society? I mentioned already that Hindus have respect for all life, supposed to at least, includes being vegetarian. For Buddhists, vegetarianism is a little bit more of a choice, but for Hindus, it's very much a part of their dharma, the way of life. But certainly, human life is kind of supreme, because humans have more potential to reach moksha. I'm sure you've heard of the term caste before. This is a Hindu concept. This is dharma. I think this is dharma taken to a certain extreme, I would say. This idea that, if what we're born into, our circumstances in life, are based upon our karma, and we shouldn't be concerned with the results of our actions, but rather just follow, act upon duty. There's this idea that therefore, whatever class, whatever family you're born into is kind of your fate for this lifetime. Traditionally, there was less of a sense that people could move through classes. You could become upper class or lower class or things like that. Rather, you were born with a caste. And the four castes that people talk about are the Brahmin, which are the priests and teachers, which were the highest caste, were considered the most capable of reaching moksha. Then beneath them were the nobles and the warriors, which were who were deemed, fit to rule. Then there were the merchant class, who kind of helped society move along. They were usually more like educated merchants and craftsmen, things like that, smiths and all that sort of thing. And then there was the servant class, which was born into their caste to take care of the other castes. There's another caste beyond that, the outcasts. You've heard of that before, I'm sure. The outcasts were born into kind of the lowest level of human society, and they were given all the worst jobs, the most impure jobs. Purity is important. It was very important within Hinduism. There are certain jobs like dealing with dead bodies, like cleaning up, fecal matter, cleaning up after animals and people, and cleaning the streets, that would taint your spiritual purity, give you kind of bad karma in a way. So there's an entire class of people who were born into that life and who were outcasts. We always say, people are treated as outcasts. That's what we're talking about, these people who couldn't come into contact with any of these other castes. Because even coming into contact with an outcast would taint you with spiritual impurity. But beyond these four castes, the book does a good job of explaining, there's another side to the caste system as well, the Jati system. The Jati is basically your ethnic, family, linguistic, religious background. India is a huge country, and it's divided between many, many different regions, and there are hundreds of languages. People don't just speak Hindu or Marathi, people speak hundreds of different languages, and each of those languages have their own dialects. And so there's a strong sense of identity with what family you're born into, what region, what village, what language you speak, what job or position in society your family is. And that plays a lot into who can marry one another, right? You always want to marry someone within your own caste, which means, these four castes, but also your Jati. And technically, legally, the caste system in India is legally no more. they've abolished the caste system, but it still remains. Especially the jati system. You're still, people know. People know what family you come from. People know what background you are, what language you speak, and that does have an impact on who you make friends with, who you make a business associates with, who you marry, especially who you marry. And I've heard, you know, a lot of young people increasingly are rejecting the caste system. I had a friend who, an Indian friend, who met a man. You know, her parents wanted to set her up, wanted to arrange a marriage. She wasn't really down with that. She met a man, and you know, it was one of these kind of things where they like fell in love, and after 2 weeks, they knew they wanted to marry each other, and they're this wonderful couple. And when she took him home to meet her family, her father took him aside, and she said she was so embarrassed that her father's first question to this man was, what is your caste? And he just said to her, you know, her boyfriend just said to her father, that system dies with my generation. And he wouldn't even answer the question. So increasingly you do see people kind of shaking off, you know, this idea of caste system. But it exists, I mean, it exists as long as people follow it. And out in the countryside, you know, in smaller villages and smaller regions, it still exists because people choose it. People choose to follow it. And it has been a part of Indian life and Hindu life for thousands of years, and it's going to stick around a little bit longer. So it's important to understand the system and that how it has religious roots. This idea of dharma, this idea of your karma, bringing you to your family and your life and the way you are. And there's another side of that as well, which we will see when we talk about yoga. But let's move on from there. So there are these four stations of life. There are also four stages of life, right? When you're young, you're a student, which means you have to learn from your elders, and you have to be respectful, and you have to learn how to be a good person. Then, your second stage of life, you become a householder, you get married, you have children, you take care of your family, and then you can retire and you can start to turn your attention towards, like, for example, social issues of poverty or taking care of people around you, of using your wisdom to help society and help the younger generations become good people. And then there's the renunciate, where a lot of Hindus will spend the last part of their life kind of just following religious duties, just focusing on devotion, and hopefully for some Hindus, trying to reach that moksha, reach that liberation. And these four stages of life kind of, in some ways, relate to the four duties of life. Again, duty, stages, stations, this is all dharma. We're talking about dharma here. Respect for all life, this is all dharma. Four duties of life have to do with the way, as a Hindu, what you do in your everyday life can be a form of devotion to God, to the gods, to divinity, to the unseen reality, however you want to put it. Different Hindus will put it differently even. But anything you do in your life, from your job to taking this class to making dinner for your family, these all can be acts of devotion if you do it with a certain attitude of devotion. And there are four different ways, four duties, but there are four parts of life that can be devotion. There's pleasure, success, social responsibilities, and religious responsibilities. Religious responsibilities is kind of an obvious one, how, you know, following your religion and devotion and trying to reach liberation, how that can be, you know, part of dharma. Social responsibilities means helping other people, being a good friend, a good husband, a good wife, a good child, being a good neighbor, you know, helping the less fortunate. These are social responsibilities. Success. That's an interesting one. Success and pleasure are interesting ones, because I think in the West we think of success and pleasure as maybe being anathema to religious success, if you will. But in Hinduism, there's kind of this point of view that, like, different people have different attributes, and not everyone has a leaning or a tendency to devote themselves to a god and be a very devout person. Not everyone has a sense of social responsibility. But success, seeking success in the material world, or seeking pleasure, can be a form of devotion. If, for example, by seeking success, you are taking care of your family, you're earning money to help them, to educate them, to feed them, that can be a form of devotion. Pleasure. Hinduism has this interesting idea about pleasure, and that is that that pleasure comes from desire, right? It's a connection between desire and pleasure. And desire not only leads to pleasure, but desire creates striving. You have a desire for something, you will strive for it. If you, even if that's a pleasure, you will strive towards it, and striving is an important part of action, proper dharma. You need to strive you need to strive to be better, you need to strive to be more devout. So there's a place for pleasure in Hinduism, and of course, pleasure and success and all of these things have certain limits. If pleasure and success and other parts of your life become destructive or cause you impurity, then obviously that's not a good thing. But certain kinds of pleasure, certain kinds of success, can be a duty, can be a form of devotion. And we'll talk a little bit more about the different kinds of devotion. So very briefly, let's look at the different philosophical systems. There's kind of two ways, in Hinduism, there's two ways of interpreting this idea of Brahman and Atman and samsara and liberation. There's this the Samkhya, and then there's the Advaita Vedanta. Samkhya is a theory, a dualistic perspective. Dualistic meaning, you know, having two sides, a black and white kind of perspective. And that is that there is the Purusha, which is the self, which is real and pure. And there's the Prakriti, which is basically everything that causes the material universe. Prakriti is the source of samsara. And that that kind of, as Krishna kind of says in the Bhagavad Gita, right? That suffering comes from confusing the two, from thinking that the self is the same as, like, this world, and that they're two very different things at odds with one another. Advaita Vedanta says that everything is all kind of one reality, right? It's not that samsara and reality are so different, but illusion, Maya, concept of illusion, makes us think that they are separate, when actually Atman and Brahman are one, and everything is part of the same reality. It's not this and that. It's all part of the same reality. But we get confused, and we think that they're separate, and we think that we're at odds with one another. And that is what confuses us and leads us to suffering. This idea of illusion and reality, it can be kind of interpreted in two ways. It could be that there's one world of illusion and one world of reality, or it can be that there's just one reality and illusion makes us think it's divided. So it's pretty interesting. Let's talk about yoga. Not with a sticky mat. Yoga is an ancient concept in India. It means union with the divine. This quote does a good job of explaining it. It says, "When the senses are stalled, when the mind is at rest, when the intellect wavers not, that, say the wise, is the highest state. This calm of the senses and the mind has been defined as yoga. It's been defined as union. One who attains it is freed from delusion." So, in order to free ourselves from delusion, just like Krishna helped Prince Arjuna, You need to calm your emotions, you need to calm your mind, all your thoughts, and when you find a calm state, then you can understand. You can understand the reality of things, and you can find union with the Brahman, which is the ultimate goal, right? To find union with the Brahman. It's very, very much a mystical idea, right? That we can free ourselves from this delusion and become one. We can meet Brahman. We can become one with Brahman because we are technically a part of Brahman. I know I should say that yoga, traditional yoga in India, it does also include the physical practice that you see in gyms and sticky mats and all that sort of thing. That is technically one form of yoga. By doing these practices, you can calm the mind and you can focus on your body and what you're doing in this moment and not be distracted by lots of different thoughts. And that can be a helpful tool. Be a helpful tool in finding this calm state of mind. But that is not yoga in and of itself. And the Indians kind of have this interesting relationship with yoga. Not all Indians do yoga. This idea that this is, everyone in India does yoga, not everyone does yoga. The asanas, the physical practice, right? Clearly this kind of yoga, the union and trying to find oneness with God, that's okay. That's what everyone does, but not the physical practice. And it still is, I mean, it's pretty widespread. I've read a lot of different things on it. I've read people saying, well, no one really does yoga anymore. Westerners know more about yoga, physical yoga, than we do. And I've also heard that there are places in India where in public schools, they've incorporated yoga into Phi Ed class and into physical education classes. And that there was, I guess there was a controversy a few years back where the government was trying to decide whether or not they could teach children yoga in public school because yoga technically kind of has some religious roots. But the way they were, but clearly you can study yoga, you can practice physical yoga without having to know anything about the religion. So there's this question about whether or not they could teach yoga if they weren't, you know, as long as in public schools in India, as long as they weren't bringing the religious side into it. Because the government is not a religious government, secular, right? They can't base any of the government upon religious ideas. Just kind of an interesting side note, not that important, but kind of interesting. Let's look at the different kinds of yoga. There are four yogas. There's karma yoga, which is the path of action through selfless service, right? So acting selflessly, helping the poor, helping the disadvantaged, which will help release built-up karma without building up new karma, right? Because you don't want any karma. There's no good karma. There's jnana yoga, which is the path of knowledge, which is trying to understand the true nature of reality and self through study, especially through study. There's Raja Yoga, which is the path of meditation, which includes asana. Asana is the name for the physical yoga that we know. Raja Yoga also includes, you know, mantras like chanting and focusing on the chakras, which are like energy points in the body. So more of these kind of physical rituals and things. And then there's Bhakti Yoga, which is the most common. It is the path of devotion, it's worship, worshiping gods. Next week, lesson four, we're going to talk all about Bhakti Yoga. We're going to talk all about it. Next lesson, lesson three, part three of the lesson on Hinduism, we're going to talk about the gods first. And then we'll go on and talk more about Bhakti Yoga. So the idea here, and you'll notice the number four is really important in Hinduism, right? There are four castes, four stages of life, four duties in life, four yogas. Four is a very important number. There are four Vedas, right? The very important Shruti texts that are the foundation of Hindu thought. There are four of those. Four is a very important number. But there's this idea here that there are different paths of seeking union with the divine. And that is because in Hinduism there's this idea that, you know, your attributes, your personality, your life where you're born into, that everyone, no matter who you are, no matter what your different attributes are, no matter where you're born, you have a way of devoting yourself to the divine, of devoting yourself to Dharma. And that not everyone, it doesn't always have to be the same way. This idea here that some people are more naturally inclined towards selfless service, which is wonderful, but not everyone's good at that. There are people who are more inclined towards study and the intellectual pursuit of the way the world is, and that can be a form of devotion. And that can be a form of seeking union with the divine. Then there's this idea that some people are better at sort of meditation and chakras and mantras and kind of this metaphysical side. And then there are people, most people, who are most inclined towards just straight devotion with a deity. And that these are all valid responses to the divine. These are all valid ways of worshiping. And it kind of goes back to the four duties of life, right? Pleasure, success, social responsibilities, religious responsibilities. There's a place for all of those. It doesn't have to be just one way. There's this wonderful story about Mahatma Gandhi. I'm sure you've heard of Gandhi. He was a great pacifist and leader in India at the end of British colonization, or British rule of India. And people, you know, sought him and asked him all sorts of questions. And there's a story that this woman came to him, came to Gandhi and said, you know, I've tried to devote myself to God, but I can't, I just find that I can't love God. Too many horrible things have happened in my life. And I almost just, she kind of says she almost couldn't wrap her head around the concept of God. She couldn't love God. She went to different temples, she went to different deities, and she couldn't do it. And Gandhi said to her, well, who do you love? And the woman thought about it, and she said, I love my nephew. She lived with her sister and her sister's husband and her nephew. She said, I take care of him every day and I love him, like more than anything. And Gandhi said to her, focus your energies on loving your nephew, and through that, you'll love God. Right? You don't have to make yourself, you know, be a way that you're not. You don't have to make yourself love something that you can't, or, devote yourself in a way that isn't appropriate to you. Whatever you do, you can do it in an attitude of devotion. You can do it in an attitude of piousness. And, through that, you can still find union with God. You can find union with Brahman. So it's a very, very interesting part of Hinduism, and it's one of the reasons why it's so diverse, why so many different Hindus, you know, practice in different ways, why belief isn't that important in Hinduism, as I mentioned before. Because from a Hindu's point of view, not everyone believes, not everyone finds it in them to believe, and there's a path for everyone. And in that vein, I have put an article in this lesson folder. It is a link to an article called When Your Faith Isn't Faith-Based, and it's an interesting article written by a man who actually converted to Hinduism, which is an unusual and strange process. Not a lot of people, you know, convert to Hinduism exactly, but he did, and he gets asked a lot about what he believes in, and if he doesn't have, you know, if he can pick and choose what God he wants to believe in, then doesn't that mean, you know, he's choosing what he wants to believe in? And it kind of flies in the face of this idea of faith, as I mentioned in the introduction. I don't think we should necessarily refer to religions as faiths, because faith isn't important to every religion. The tradition is important, the practices and the beliefs, they're all important, the identity is important. The identity comes with that religion. Religious tradition is important. So I'm going to have you read that. But for the discussion, something very specific I want you to do. First, I want you to answer the question on the discussion, how do you understand Dharma at this point, right? Dharma is this big, complicated idea. based upon everything we've talked about, how do you understand Dharma? What do you think it means? Just put it in your own words. There's no right or wrong here. I want you to put it in your own words. How do you understand it? And then read the article when your faith isn't faith-based. And in it, he says, it's not what I want to believe. It's about what I'm able to believe. And look at read the entire article. Look at this quote in particular and the context that it's put in. How does he use this quote? And then answer the second discussion question. How does this statement relate to the concept of Dharma? So just first, I want you to answer the question, what is Dharma? Just because I want you to try to kind of internalize this idea and put it into your own words and get a grasp on it, because it really is important. And then we'll look at it in context. Okay? So I know this has been a big lesson. I know that we've had done a lot of big ideas. Please look at the book. Please review the vocabulary words that we went over in this lecture and take some time to think about it. The third lecture is going to be so much lighter, I promise. It's going to be about the different gods, and there's going to be talk about art and stories, and it's going to be much easier. And I planned the lessons this way on purpose because I want you to spend more time on part two, on this part of the lesson on Hinduism. And the next one, you can kind of relax a little bit and listen to the stories and look at the pretty artwork. Okay? So please email me with questions. Okay?